Piranha Bytes, a dedicated RPG developer. The studio has been developing essentially the same game under a different coat of paint for over 2 decades. That's a long time, 2 decades. Some might even say it's too long. Worth mentioning that up until 2017, said coat of paint had been getting progressively less appealing. What's that saying? Practice makes... perfect.
Perfect in Schlag.
Practice makes perfect, right? Yet in Piranha Bytes' case, it seems to go almost the opposite way. The more games they make, the shittier they get. Although that's not strictly true. I am exaggerating a little, because Gothic 1 and 2 were incredible. Then they shat the bed with the third one. Then Risen came along. And it was fine. Nothing groundbreaking for sure, but it was a step in the right direction. Fast forward 3 years and Risen 2 gets released. That game was garbage.
What is that?
This is
fucking pile of shit! Blood!
And the third one wasn't much better either. Then Elex came along. 3 years it baked in the peculiar mediocrity machine they've been using to develop games for 20 years at that point. It was better than Risen 2 or 3, sure, but it was not a good game, objectively speaking. There was some amount of joy to be had, provided you were resilient enough to stick with it long enough, but that's quite the rough selling pitch. Elex, it's okay. Even fun at times. You just gotta suck it up for a few hours. Piranha Bytes crawled back into its den, making sure to cover the entrance carefully so it wouldn't be disturbed while it worked on its next project. Elex 2. The studio's 8th role-playing game. One that took 5 years to produce. Would have probably been 3 or 4 if not for the groundbreaking Cold 2.0 update that took the world by storm back in 2020. Elex 2 released in March 2022 and just... Man, what an unfortunate release date. A month after Elden Ring and Forbidden West. I have zero doubts in my mind that, more than anything, this was the cause of such low player count compared to its predecessor. All-time peak of just 8 measly 1,000 concurrent players on Steam, presumably the platform of choice for all Piranha Bytes games. That's pretty rough. Before we dig into the meat of the matter, let me just recommend a few mods to you. Firstly, playing Elex 2 with default field of view is like wearing blinders. Remember how 22 years ago we could zoom in and out as much as we wanted to? Grab the static camera from Nexus to remedy that unfortunate design choice. Next up, we have brighter flashlight. Vanilla flashlight is dog shit, and contrary to what its name might suggest, it ain't a flash, nor a light. It's like lighting up a single match and holding it up hoping it does the trick. These are the only mods I played the entire game with. Upon completion of Elex 2, I gave sockets for ranged weapons and aim assist enhanced a go. They seemed like the kind of mods that would enhance the experience without altering the gameplay in a significant way that could potentially feel like cheating.
Ну что делаешь?
Ваня, опять ты как шлюх! Ваня, опять ты как шлюх! Ваня, опять ты как шлюх! Ваня, опять ты как шлюх!
Melee weapons have sockets that you can fill with gems or whatever the fuck they're called that provide minor, and I mean fucking minor, stat bonuses. Ranged weapons do not have sockets, which feels odd. On one hand, you're not at any real disadvantage, while on the other, if you choose to play a strictly ranged character, then you are missing out on a feature for no good reason. As for aim assist enhanced, let me put it this way. Firstly, it's a Piranha Bytes game, and I'd rather shit in my hands and clap than to play a melee character. Secondly, I generally dislike playing with aim assist. I am what a common pleb might call an ultra chad. I like my games how I like my car. However, having played through 80% of the game as a ranged character, I can confidently make the following statement. Aiming in this game is fucking horrific. Shots oftentimes just fly off in random directions for no good reason. Well, shitty programming, I guess. You lose focus at random, and even though you're still aiming at your target, you ain't hitting it. You get the idea. Vanilla aim assist, while somewhat helpful, doesn't fix the problem entirely, as the game will at random lose focus. But you're not moving your mouse because you have aim assist. You see where I'm going with this, right? Aim assist enhanced. It's not perfect, but it's damn close. Magus the Magician. I expect 10% of all of your future profits for this plug. Before you take the plunge with me, be warned. I will probably spoil some major events from the game. I will, however, do my best to contain them to a specific section of the review, so you should be safe. No guarantees though. I mean, I'm only starting to write the script, and I don't plan on returning to this section to make amendments. A draft? A rewrite? Not on my channel.
We'll do it live! Fuck it! Do it live! I'll write it and we'll do it live! Fucking thing sucks!
Story /spoilers / go here to avoid them. In Elex 2, you take on the role of the former Alp commander, known to some as the Beast of Zako, which is a badass nickname, and the beginning cutscene shows the Archangel Tyriel plummet straight through the roof of your house. Apart from looking younger than he did in Elex 1, bizarrely enough, Jax also carries a permanent look of bewilderment. It must be a result of his failed attempts at uniting the factions of Magellan to join forces and prepare for the invaders summoned by the hybrid prior to his defeat. This sounds vaguely familiar.
With his final furious scream, the Sleeper has set into movement the armies of darkness. It was an order to all evil creatures, a word of power that they were all bound to obey. His last order was, "Come," and they came, all of them, even the dragons.
Dragons?
For those among us who value their time and don't play these games, Magellan equals Earth, whereas the hybrid was the last game's antagonist and the leader of the Albs, a faction I'll get to in a minute. Between the two entries, Jax and Kaya, spelled C-A-J-A, fucked and produced one hell of an ugly fucking kid. And I guess you weren't the only man whose seed she bore, as running around the fort is exactly the same looking kid, but with blonde hair instead. Sometime down the line, Jax threw a temper tantrum and abandoned his family to live in exile because of the faction's inability to unite as one against the imminent threat of the alien invasion. Jax gets bitten by one of the Skyan trackers, and despite appearing to be dead, he merely lost consciousness so that Adam, formerly the hybrid, could rescue him in the nick of time. As an unfortunate result of the bite, Jax will be delivering highly unnecessary monologues every time he gets out of bed and throughout the entire game.
Looks like I still have a long, painful road ahead. Damn infection. The worst thing about this disease is the feeling like I'm losing control. Ugh, my head. Infection. Forgotten about it again. I should train my mind before that one thing happens to me. Okay. I need to concentrate. I should train my mind before that thing happens to me. Unbelievable. Jarx. Bara. Isura. Attack.
Unfortunately, I have to diagnose you with cringe.
Jax has a seemingly impossible task ahead of him, to unite the factions, regain their trust, for some inexplicable reason, despite literally saving everybody's lives back in Elex 1, and to create his own sixth faction, cleverly called the Sixth Power, based in the Bastion, which has Inquisition vibes to it, I'm not gonna lie. Of course, it's nowhere near as sophisticated in terms of literally everything, but that's besides the point. And not that Inquisition Skyhold was phenomenal or anything, but it certainly had its charms, like sitting on the throne, gathering with your advisors, sending your troops on missions, judging people, or undergoing an actual transformation as the story progressed. Before we leave spoiler town, why don't I show you the final boss of Elex 2 on ultra difficulty as a berserker mage?
Enough of this. I have duties to fulfill, and you
are in my way. You have accomplished much and created no end of problems for us. But it ends now.
I'm not scared of you.
You will be once you witness my powers. You pathetic human.
Who knows what awaits me at the end of this journey? The next evolutionary step for humanity? Or just another monster? I'm gonna find out, I guess. Skyans didn't just breed this species because of the singularity. The changelings are their new weapon to take us all down.
Yeah, Piranha Bytes never were great at designing boss fights. Sleeper, Under Dragon, Titan, Hybrid, and now this.
So perhaps you should put off anything too demanding for a few days.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is pretty much the premise. I could go over Dawkins gaining the ability of a Skyand when we kick the shit out of him towards the end of the game, meaning he will definitely appear in Elex 3, or how Dex, our ugly child, apparently dies inside a massage bed at Skyand HQ, and neither Jax nor his mother Kaya really give a shit, which was hilarious by the way. Not a single line of dialogue between the two about their son's apparent death, not even in the ending slideshow straight out of the early 2000s. And if I may be so bold as to spoil the events of the next game for you, he's not dead. I mean, they foreshadowed him turning into a Skyand in the announcement trailer, for fuck's sake. I could also go over the enigmatic singularity which Dawkins and the Skyans make out to be the antagonist of the next installment, but since we don't know anything about it, save for the fact that Elex was extracted from it and it is now floating towards Magellan to reclaim what was taken from it by Dawkins scientists, oh yeah, that's how Elex came to this planet in the first place. Before the events of the first game, Dawkins sent a group of scientists who eventually became the first Skyans into space, aboard spaceship Cassandra, in search of something that could prolong his life. That's Elex. The scientists couldn't send the substance back to Magellan in time, so they crashed a spacecraft carrying it into the comet that was heading for Magellan anyway. Bada bing, bada boom. Elex 2 consists of 4 chapters, although unlike in Gothic 1 and 2, they don't change the world in a significant way, save for an increase in Skyans throughout Magellan. Wouldn't it have been cool if maybe the Formers were actually terraforming Magellan and the planet would become progressively more alien with each chapter? Chronicles of Myrtana, a free-to-play Gothic 2 mod, did this much better. Eventually, with each new chapter, you will encounter more orcs, their ships and camps. It actually felt like the island was about to be invaded. Monsters respawn after 5 days, more or less, in Elex 2, and joining a faction and moving up in the ranks depends entirely on Jax's level. Only the first rank I am not too sure of, but I think to join a faction you must be level 10. To advance further, level 20 is needed, and for the top dog rank, Jax gots to be level 30. They actually did a decent job with pacing the game, as long as you don't play it like you would a traditional Piranha Bytes game. And what I mean by that is you shouldn't focus on doing all the side content before progressing the main story. Treat it like an entree instead. Have a little bit of everything, rather than obliterating the sides before digging into the star of the dish. Otherwise, you may end up running from A to B in late game non-stop, having to kill literally tens of enemies, and trust me, it gets old real fucking quick. Especially since, unfortunately, you kind of stop caring about gear and experience at a certain point, because you become so powerful that you don't really need anything else. This kind of killed the game for me a little, as I had no desire to continue looting or leveling up. Towards the very end, I wouldn't even clear the Sky and Formers that I had to visit to complete a quest. I'd just fly past anything that could be avoided. Unlike in some of their previous games, joining a faction in Elex 2 doesn't prohibit you from doing quests with the others. That is to say, go and join one as soon as possible, to make everything a bit more accessible. I'm all for running around with a metal pipe and having my companions do the hard work for me, provided there is a reason for it. As things are, the sooner you join one of the main three factions, the better your overall experience is going to be, especially if you want to be a mage, as magic skills are locked behind a faction. You can also complete the game without joining anybody, which is a Piranha Bytes first, though I can't speak for that experience, seeing as I had berserker blood running through my veins. I also couldn't help but notice that the whole parenthood idea was seriously half-baked. The amount of time I spent with Dex could probably be measured in minutes, which is a letdown. Don't get me wrong, as things stand, I'm happy that I didn't have to spend more time with this fucklet, but I just wish they had fully committed to it instead of half-assing it. That might be their hidden motto, actually. Piranha Bytes. Never give 100% to anything. Obviously, I am not expecting God of War excellency from them, but it practically boils down to, hello player, Jax has a son now. He is going to be completely insignificant past the first hour of the game, until the very end, where he gets another 20 minutes of fame. I guess what I am trying to say is that it paints a picture of a game that has all the right ideas with nearly none of them executed to perfection or near it, which is a shame. All in all, I think the story is decent enough. It's certainly not groundbreaking in any way, but it's not bad either. Major information is given to you in the last two chapters, and it kept me sufficiently engaged. I just wish it wasn't spoiled by these all too frequent kill quests. Alright lads, shall we make predictions for Elex 3? I think that in between the entries, Jax and Kaya will have spent some time searching for Dex or his body to no avail. At some point in the game, Dex will be revealed as half Skyand, half human, and he will be hostile up until a certain point. Perhaps Dawkins is going to be controlling him. If not, then Dex will come out of nowhere to save the day during an important main story quest, having spent years learning about the singularity. I think that the final boss fight will either be against the singularity itself or Dawkins after he somehow absorbs or is in control of it. Now, what could be the cause behind Jax having to start from scratch again? I think that Dawkins will detach himself from Jax. Oh yeah, Dawkins made Jax into a horcrux of sorts as a failsafe. And that will be the cause of his renewed wimpiness. Could also be that we begin our journey as Giga Jax and the detachment happens an hour or two into the game. Would be a shame if I turn out to be wrong about all of these, huh? Spoilers over, kids. You may uncover thine ears now. It's okay. Shh. You're safe. I got you. Now, this next section is going to be divided into smaller subsections, which may be divided into even smaller subsections, like a Matryoshka doll. That section is gameplay.
Incredible.
Since I don't want it to seem like the goal of the video is to just continuously shit on Piranha Bytes, we'll kick off with some of the positives. Exploration. It's probably Piranha's strongest suit. Creating a world that's genuinely fun to explore. One that you can quite easily lose yourself in and forget about those pesky alternates hiding in your bedroom closet. Running through Caracas, Tavar or Ignadon never felt like a chore for two main reasons. First one being that wherever you end up traveling to, there is always something piquing your curiosity. A distant tower or castle, factories, warehouses, settlements, caves, you name it. And unlike in Elex 1, exploring them is actually rewarding this time around. You can quite easily find new and exciting gear and upgrade materials. By the way, if you want to use energy rifles, go here and climb atop the converter. You'll find Calaan's Light here, the most powerful energy rifle I came across. Calaan's Light, and yes, it is pronounced Calaan, obviously has endgame requirements, but you can raise those fairly quickly with Rain of Fire. And yes, it is a ridiculously overpowered spell that overshadows just about everything else. Just gotta make sure that you're careful on your way to the converter and you can literally grab the weapon and a large Elex drink 10 minutes into the game. Allow me to demonstrate. Here, new game. Ultra difficulty. Let's fast forward until we're finished talking with Dawkins. Here's the converter. And off we go in search of truth and a little fun. We're gonna zip past that pesky bloodfly and carry on our merry way. Top tip for such perilous travels would be to always keep an eye on your stamina, as you want it to be full when approaching enemies like that jackal or ogre. Past Raptor Reskin number 3 and we carry on. If you look to your left, you'll see the fort, which had formerly belonged to the Outlaws. If you look straight ahead, you can already see our destination, playfully peeking through the woods at us, smiling back at us even. Again, to our left, you'll encounter a few mass rats that need to be slain to complete a quest in the fort. We're gonna cut through the lake here, less chances of landing in murky waters. Hello, Mr. Jackal or Spinehound, I don't really know the difference between the two. Let's go around it to avoid any unpleasantries. Almost there, folks. Just gotta sneak past dog-like creature Reskin number 12 and up we go. Just do as I do and the treasures atop the converter are yours. Second factor that makes exploration so much fun is the trusty old jetpack. I don't remember how it worked in Elex 1 exactly, but I know it was nowhere near this complex, I guess, for the lack of a better word. It really adds a unique flavor to the game, being able to maneuver Magellan. Or is it Magellan now, Mr. Narrator?
Magellan. Magellan.
As you see fit, the Elden Rings, Witches, and Skyrims all have their mounts. Piranha Bytes does too. And I think that's actually a really clever solution. It's less cumbersome than traveling on horseback, as you oftentimes have to dismount to loot or fight, whereas the jetpack gives you an enhanced sense of freedom, not seen in a lot of RPGs. Despite Torrent being easily the best mount I ever played with, the jetpack takes the cake in my opinion. That being said, I think there are ways in which they could very easily improve or even perfect the jetpack. It would be cool if you could integrate it into your armor, for instance. Imagine being able to connect your jetpack to your boots to grant them thrusters, enabling you to turbo sprint. This could even be a special attack like the Juggernaut from X-Men, for example. You could then build upon it further by installing special shoulder bumpers onto your armor that would increase the impact or damage caused or stun your enemies. Imagine also being able to use it as a weapon, having additional thrusters in your gloves. It could be a special attack that causes massive amounts of damage but eats your entire fuel supply and recharges slower than normal. You could have faction-specific designs or bonuses, since we pretty much abandoned the idea that berserkers, for example, despise technology. Imagine having a motherfucking Boeing 747 attached to your lower spine. What about a self-contained minigame tied to an achievement that asks you to splatter birds on the flight? What about implementing additional physics that would make it so that when you crash into a tree or a wall, you absolutely obliterate said object, depending on your speed? Speed being upgradable past the basic level? What about a special magic combo, wherein you envelop yourself in a barrier protecting you from damage and you crash into your enemies for extreme damage? And, more importantly, spectacle. Just think about it. Being able to essentially turn into Rodan and crash into a river or screamer splattering their guts all over. Let me wrap up the exploration part of the video by saying that they pretty much removed environmental hazards entirely. Thrice I came across a poisonous area. First one was in an iron mine. Second in the Sky Informer, while the third was somewhere in the woods. As for heat, it's still tied to Ignadon, but since Ignadon is now covered in snow, it doesn't really affect you. Ever. And cold meter only ever graced my screen after I completed the game and began my journey to heaven with my unlimited jetpack. Let's go over the combat system now. I played the game for about 60-ish hours, most of which I spent successfully avoiding melee combat, so it's only fitting that I provide my expert opinion on it. It's better than it was in Elex 1, I will give them that, okay? It's no longer quite as robotic and inanimate as it was 6 years ago when Jax was considerably older, strangely enough. However, it is still very much a Piranha Bytes combat system with all the wonders of modern Eurojank. Eurojank 8.0. Monsters continue attacking in a straight path, unable to change direction. Hitboxes are unfortunate, as if every character in the game had an invisible rectangle around their figure that determines whether they get hit or not. Seriously, if you want to play Elex 2, I implore you to seek reason and just play on a lower difficulty setting, or just spec into magic. Berserker magic, or should I say Rain of Fire really, is ridiculously overpowered, and while balancing was never Piranha's strong suit, it can actually be fun to fly around Superman style and absolutely shit on everything in the vicinity. Ranged weaponry is unfortunately quite underwhelming, however. That may not actually be a problem with the weapons themselves, rather with enemy scaling on high difficulty levels. Ranged weapons, and melee ones too actually, do so little damage compared to magic that trying to turn Jax into an archer or rifleman is kinda like choosing to have no anesthetic at the dentist, despite it being offered free of charge. It's doable, but at what cost? Magic, on the other hand, makes the game ultra easy, especially towards the end. I was literally plowing through the strongest of enemies. There was only one creature resistant to my broken fire magic, and that was the Ember Wolf, which died to two shots from my rifle anyway. Just look at this. Anything even remotely resembling a challenge disappeared the second I acquired Rain of Fire, and while it was still fun for a while to effortlessly shit on everything in sight, it did eventually get boring when none would survive long enough to even attempt a counterattack. Which leads me back to something I briefly mentioned earlier. Monsters respawn every 5 or so days. Even without trying to abuse this, I was able to acquire so many crafting materials and so much gold that eventually I had everything.
That's it. You keep pushing me, questioning my authority. No more! My head.
Man, Jax's father really got his ass handed to him, huh? Let's Honorable mention goes to Firewave, which Principal Tayak didn't handle so well.
No idea. Believe it. That fucking son of a bitch.
It's also a little costly in terms of mana, but it has its uses. Shame it can be used whilst Rain of Fire is active. Bit weird for a single player game that is already pretty bad at balancing to prohibit you from using certain spells concurrently. Nearly all of my skills were maxed out by the end of the game, and I had so much gold but nothing to spend it on. Same as Hogwarts Legacy, now that I think about it. That game has some serious problems with economy. Elex and Dark Elex potions are really easy to craft, and the main ingredients can be farmed from monsters too, so on top of earning ridiculous amounts of experience, you also have a never-ending supply of permanent stat potions. Leading off of that, leveling up gets somewhat tedious as soon as you come to the painful realization that most skills, unless they grant specific abilities, such as lockpicking or hacking, are just flat increases to damage and whatnot. Come here. Come closer. Come. Look at all of these skills with just lame, unimaginative improvements. They're hardly skills. They're perks that ideally would have been integrated into the attributes and replaced with something that at least somewhat resembled actual skills. In place of some extra damage with bows and crossbows, how about you shoot farther or ready your next shot a bit quicker? How about headshots now deal critical damage? How about gaining the ability to craft elemental arrows and bolts? Of course, this would also mean that enemies and their resistances would have had to have gone through a major overhaul, but these are all things that in the long run would benefit everybody, their company, and us, the players. Yes, it's cool to do more damage, but if that's all that is on offer, and I have to slug through 60 hours of this thing, then eventually the coolness of doing 10 extra damage per hit disappears. Especially when said damage is still so fucking minimal on higher difficulties. There are ways around this, and I think the fact that they haven't integrated any of them feels like laziness. You can't tell me that you need a team of 100 plus devs working on a game for 4 years to be able to come up with and implement exciting skills. Moving on, a reminder that I personally played on ultra difficulty, so what I'm about to say may differ for some. There was one situation wherein I was forced to reduce it to story mode, due to no fault of my own, mind you. When I first met Fox, one of the companions, he invited me on a sightseeing tour round the old Magalan. We quickly encountered a problem, which was awful enemy placement on Piranha's part, and as a result, it would have been nigh impossible to complete this quest successfully without fucking around with the difficulty. Maybe if I went strength instead of dexterity or intelligence, and if I specced into melee combat perks, I could have handled this. Maybe. Even though by the end of the game, Jax was a master of everything, I couldn't have known that that would have been the case at the start of my journey with Elex 2, so I was saving up my attribute points and choosing profitable perks such as lockpicking, animal trophies and such. Aside from that one scenario, the beginning was a little rough, but manageable. They handled it much better than in Elex 1, where even fighting a rat at the beginning of the game felt like duking it out with Dark Eater Medea. This is how they've been handling difficulty in their games since Gothic 3. That's 17 years ago, mind you. 17 years of awful balance. Reducing damage dealt by the player or increasing the enemy hit points are terrible ways of imitating challenge. It's not a challenge. It's a ball ache. Piranha Bytes, I implore you to cease this nonsense at once. I know they can do better. I know they've got it in them. How do I know that? Because they've done exactly that in Gothic 2 Night of the Raven. It wasn't perfect for sure, but critical hits would hit for full damage, and it was more or less balanced. Yeah, the first few hours were a slog, but after a while you could do some serious damage to enemies, and that was by no means a short game. If I remember correctly, completing Gothic 2 Night of the Raven was a 50-ish hour endeavor. To fully complete Elex 2 would have probably taken me another 5 or 10 hours, making it a 70-ish hour journey, which is not much longer. I don't know. I know it's not Dark Souls, I get that, and I'm not even asking for it to be more like Dark Souls. I just wish for a difficulty slider that doesn't turn every single enemy into a so-called bullet sponge. Increase the damage the player is dealt, that's fine. reduce parry timings, increase stat requirements for combat perks, or introduce having to repair equipment and make it so your shit wears out more easily. Do something. Anything other than cranking that enemy health bar slider all the way to the stratosphere. Actually, guys, I created a GoFundMe page in order to hire an external game designer for Piranha. They desperately need somebody to do something about their combat system. Elex 3 can still be saved. It's only been in active development for about a year. This is not a joke. This is serious stuff. Please, donate whatever you can. They need our help now, more than ever. We mustn't let Elex 3 flop. I touched on crafting early on, so let's blast through that real quick. Crafting is basic. You only really need alchemy in order to brew permanent potions. Crafting weapons, ammo, or socketing gems are features that would change absolutely nothing had they been removed from the game entirely. Like I mentioned earlier, I was using energy rifles and the amount of ammo I could craft for them myself was so very pitiful. It almost felt like it was put in the game for a laugh. Like the devs just laughing in your face once you come to the realization that you essentially wasted a couple of skill points. As for crafting weapons, it may have just as easily been a blacksmith exclusive feature. Visit a blacksmith, have enough materials on hand, and pay him to upgrade your gear. Simple, and it would have worked just fine. It wouldn't have changed anything. It's not like you can find crafting schematics or anything remotely interesting. It is literally a matter of collecting three damaged weapons of the same type, upgrading them, then gathering some dark elix, if I'm not mistaken, and upgrading the weapon further. Literally zero depth to it. Which is a shame, because if I remember correctly, Elex 1 did have schematics in it. I am sure that all that whole system needed was a little refinement, as is the case for most of the things Piranha designs. Now, to be fair to Piranha Bytes, armor progression is something they continuously do fairly well. Just the right amount of time in between upgrades, which are meaningful enough too. I only wish that we could modify the armors a little, or upgrade them further, or maybe just have a couple more sets available to us. I reached the rank of a Berserker Warlord fairly quickly, and then I had nothing else waiting for me. No secret or just difficult to obtain armor. It wouldn't even have to be overpowered. A touch better in terms of stats, and hella better in terms of looks would have been fine with me. Lastly, I arrive at the enemies and their variety. At a glance, Elex 2 sports an impressive roster of monsters to shoot, blast, beat the shit out of, and engulf in flames. Around 70 different types of enemies. Wow, that's impressive, right? Unfortunately, they are divided as follows. 16 varieties of dog creatures, 6 crawlers, 5 lurkers, 6 trolls, 6 shadow beasts, 1 robot, 5 humanoids, 3 drones, 5 birds, 6 raptors, 6 ogres, 5 flying whatevers, and 1 elemental. You know the difference between Lurker 1 and Lurker 2? Their skin and stats. Exactly the same behavior and attacks otherwise, which is underwhelming to say the least. They look cool enough, I will give them that, but it's once again a praise about something rather basic. Time to go over the factions and companions, latter of which will contain some spoilers. Fear not though, I will warn you beforehand. Theoretically, the game has 6 factions. Those are Albs, who have adapted a new directive and are experimenting with lowering dosage of Elex to experience some emotions. They are still all about efficiency though. Unfortunately for every other faction, the Albs house the only pediatric cancer ward in all of Magellan. They have cool looking armor sets, but their settlement is kind of basic, I guess is the word I'm looking for. It technically looks okay, and it certainly fits the faction, so I don't really know what my problem is, but it just feels a little too basic for me. Very uniform, which again, I guess is what they were going for, but still. I wouldn't mind something exciting to look at here or there. Berserkers took over the fourth from the Outlaws between Elex 1 and 2, and they are still all about nature, cultivation, and magic. They did, however, adapt their worldview and now permit technology in their ranks. The fort will likely be the first settlement the players visit, and for good reason. It's vibrant looking and it just feels alive.
You want to explain yourself? Grab that towel right there, please. Wrap it around yourself, and please sit in that stool. What are you doing?
Making a mistake.
Morkans are the new grumps. They've been quite literally living under a rock for a while, and they worship Ravak, God of Destruction, or some shit like that. They're all about oblivion.
You are the one from my dreams.
Death, and all that fun stuff. While I myself did not particularly get into their whole fuck shit up agenda, I must admit that their armors are pretty sick. Then we have the clerics, from whom the albs originally originated. Clerics are all about technology and their fake god Calaan. Unlike the albs though, they do not consume Elex in its raw form. And lastly, we have the Outlaws, and I sincerely and faithfully have disliked that faction since Elex 2017. I just don't think that their potential has been utilized properly. They are just a bunch of edgelords swearing constantly and not really caring about anything or anybody. Think about it, they could have been made into a Robin Hood type of a figure. The ones who accept everybody, regardless of their creed, beliefs or past in general. A place where technological innovation could coexist with religion. Everybody working together to build a better tomorrow for all of Magellan. Those who right the wrongs committed by others, I don't know. Just feels like a waste to make the Outlaws into a band of good-for-nothing degenerates that like to swear. They're essentially the lowlies from the new camp from Gothic 1, with no reason to be the way they are. The scum from the new camp had an actual reason for being the way they were. They were all prisoners mining ore for the king, and once Gomez did what Gomez does, they were free to indulge themselves however the fuck they wanted, as long as the camp did not suffer. They could do whatever the fuck they felt like doing. They had no reason to be better. They were entrapped in a magic barrier that, as far as they could tell, nobody would get through anytime soon. It just felt different, is what I am saying. And of course, the sixth faction, which technically is no faction in and of itself, but I bet you anything it will be in Elex 3. Side quest spoilers up ahead, go here to avoid. Quests can be broken down into the following categories: main, faction, side and companion, and they are for the most part well done. I could do without the writing that can sometimes feel like a teenager wrote this stuff.
That'll teach you to talk back to me. Well, look what we have here. Just in time for our little party. Looks like this one's finished. But I'm not, so what do you think? Want to take his place?
No thanks, bro.
That being said though, except of those late game quests that you have to teleport all over the map and endlessly slaughter hordes of enemies, I think I enjoyed most of the quests the game throws at you. A couple of the more notable ones had me give Hank some Elexit, Elex's currency, and return to him after 3 days for something special, as that's what he allegedly deals in. After 3 days had passed, he gave me a golden ingot and told me to offer it to Vivienne in the cleric's castle. And what do you know? Hank fucked me over. He didn't live long enough to regret his actions though. Another quest had Billy from Stranger Things try to get me whacked behind the tavern. Things didn't work out for him in Elex either. Certain companion quests can get in the way and feel almost like Todd Howard's Radiant quests, especially if you've been away from the Bastion, which serves as the Sixth Power's head office. That's when they really get you. And the worst part is that they don't just give them to you immediately upon finishing one off. No, they will instead lull you into a false sense of security and peace as they let you be for like a minute, only to then pounce back at you with what is essentially the same quest, just in a different location. Kaya and Crony are most guilty of these crimes, that rusty little fuck especially. With Kaya, the quests are at least short. Whisk me away to a random location. I dispatch a few easy to deal with foes. You kneel in dog shit. done. Crony's quests are just too long on the other hand, and there is definitely too many of them.
Commander. Commander. Commander.
You need to shut the fuck up!
Fox's quests are also a bit like that, but they at least have a different backstory to them. It's nothing phenomenal, but it keeps things somewhat fresh at least. He did have one interesting quest that involved tracking down his mother, who Fox believed died in Tumsen Town when he was a child. Well, I guess what is only so interesting because I tracked her down by good old-fashioned exploration rather than following a marker. I also didn't read the journal, so I wasn't sure what I was gonna find to begin with. But anyway, it's a cool idea for a quest, right? This is their reunion. Mother and son, finally together after a few decades.
Oh man.
Oh my boy, can it really be you? Ravak, it is!
Ulf, that bastard, my father, he will pay for this. He will.
Revenge won't get us back the years. It'll only waste more, you know?
But he can't just...
We're together now. That's all that matters.
Oh, man.
Oh, my boy. Can it really be you? Ravak, it is.
Ulf, that bastard. My father. He will pay for this. He will.
Revenge won't get us back the years. It'll only waste more, you know?
But he can't just...
We're together now. That's all that matters.
Oh, man.
Oh, my boy. Can it really be you? Ravak, it is.
Ulf, that bastard. My father.
Shit!
Revenge won't get us back the years. It'll only waste more, you know?
But he can't just...
We're together now.
Fucking hell, Piranha. That's it? You see, there are some things you simply cannot blame on being a small studio. This right here isn't due to a lack of manpower. This is either laziness or lack of imagination. Period. Bully's quests might be good. Bully's quests might be bad. Who knows? I don't. He is forced onto your team and he isn't exactly likable. So I just ended up ignoring his requests for help. His and Naira's too. Well, I did a couple of Naira's quests, but unfortunately for her, I got to a late game, and your boy was slowly losing interest in questing at that point, if I'm being honest. However, given that companion quests always revolve around the same thing, you wouldn't miss anything by not continuing her questline. They're about stealing strategic plans from the clerics, possibly some other faction down the line, and Piranha couldn't even bother writing or drawing those out for us. They just say, an experienced tactician will be able to make sense of these. How about this? You don't half-ass your quests, and then I won't half-ass my videos. How is that for a compromise, Piranha? Nasty's quests are fucking unbearable. Here's what she wants from you. Formerly an outlaw, now a Morkon emissary. She wants you to take her to leaders of all the factions to make peace with them. That's what she tells you, right? This is how they all play out.
Oh, one more thing. This is, Nasty. She's,
Ah, I see that she is a representative of the Morkons.
And I see that you're one of those chalky-ass oppressive fucks who thinks he's better than everybody else.
Oh, no.
Wait, something's not right here. Don't say a fucking word.
I don't get it. What is wrong with you?
I know these quests aren't really about diplomacy, and she, I think, seeks revenge on those who stabbed her in the back after the events of Elex 1, but you add this up to the fact that she, as a character, is written so atrociously, so cringily, that I just eventually told her to fuck off.
This is your crusade, not mine. Maybe it's best I don't get involved.
Fine, then fuck off and stay out of my way. I already told you I didn't need your sorry ass.
Fuck you.
I couldn't bear listening to that forced edginess. Last but not least, we arrive at Falk. And what you need to know about Falk is that he's my man. My guy, my G, the OG. I thoroughly enjoyed doing Falk's quests, which take you on a journey of trying to understand humans and to become more like them. His voice acting is spot on too.
Out with it.
He wants to fight you.
What the hell? You, need some training?
Yes. No. What I mean is, I need you to...
Don't be afraid. If you want to fight me...
It's not that.
Then what?
The maniac wants you to thrash him.
Sorry, what?
That might be putting it too casually. The easiest way would be for me to provoke you, but that would be...
impolite?
So,
his quests range from trying to gift meat to people in need, which doesn't go as he envisioned it to essentially becoming a mercenary for some gang I no longer remember the name of. The Psychos, I think. This quest right here has so much potential. However, Piranha just wrote the first half of it and then crumbled it up and shoved it up their assholes. Just watch this. This is how the conversation with Falk went.
Was that the last of them? Yes. The Sykes are all taken care of. Excellent. Then we can move on to the next item on today's agenda. I'm afraid I can't do that. As well as putting yourself in danger. You've caused a lot of harm to other people. Other humans. That's not something I can just ignore. I understand. What do you intend to do? Honestly, I don't know yet. I need to think about how I can regain my trust in you. I have to know you can be relied upon. That is a logical response. I will also take some time to reflect upon this matter. Yes, do that. What happened with the Sykes, it can never happen again. Your wishes are clear. I will adjust accordingly.
Jarks. Bara. Isura. Tatak. Jarts.
Get the fuck out of here!
Are you kidding me? You see why this is so frustrating to the point of being infuriating, right? Everything Piranha Bytes messes up is just teeming with untapped potential. Spoilers over, folks.
And amongst the living are seen carriers of the accursed dark side.
Elex 2 companions are far more useful than the ones from Elex 1. Word. For real though, while they would still rather turn the other cheek at times, they are definitely more reactive and aggressive than before. As for their pathfinding, I would go as far as to say it's actually impressive. Thank fuck, as it's not something Piranha Bytes have been particularly good at in the past. You can romance certain female characters, but that entire aspect of the game is so half-assed that I'd rather just pretend it didn't exist to begin with. And no, I don't need steamy fuckatons or daily blowjob sessions before Jax heads off to bed to regenerate mana in order to enjoy romance in video games, but just make it interesting, I guess. Make me want to engage with my love interest, not out of my need as a player to extract every last bit of information available to me, but just because I genuinely enjoy what they have to say. Time for a good old-fashioned ranking. It's like I'm playing a BioWare game. Well, the old BioWare, I guess. Though who knows, they might redeem themselves with Dreadwolf Rises. It won't be a battle capability-oriented ranking, mind you, as how you choose to play Jax will have an impact on who's useful and who isn't. Falk, easily S-tier. Best writing, best voice acting, not much else to say. Kaya makes it to A-tier. I mean, she is the mother of my son, whom I'm sure Jax loves very much in an alternate universe. Her actress does a good job in all fairness, and her quests, while not the most thrilling, are not a massive pain in the ass. Crony, Fox, and Naira make it to C tier. These three are the ones you don't mind having around you. You might not be excited about traveling alongside them, but you don't actively dislike having them near you either. We have nothing in D nor E tiers. Bully and Nasty find themselves all the way at the bottom in F tier. Bully might, and that's a might written in italic, be interesting down the line. But because he was forced into my crew and continues threatening Jax, despite having had a few teeth knocked out by him at the beginning of their relationship, just makes me not want to have anything to do with him. And of course, we have Nasty, just a terribly written, edgy dominatrix. It wouldn't surprise me if they just killed her off in Elex 3, as I honestly doubt many players will enjoy her character. Graphics are up next. It's definitely a Piranha Bytes game. You can tell the second it loads you into the game.
Excuse me! I'm in need of medical attention!
And it's not necessarily an insult, despite definitely sounding like one. It's just, it is what it is. They handle lighting in a strange way. It's actually pretty realistic, as in real life, when you walk into a dark room after having been out in the sun, your eyes will take a second or two to adjust as well, but that's not necessarily a part of realism that I crave in my games. It's got this classic high fantasy look to it, and I enjoy that. Everybody's so obsessed with hyper-realism these days, and while it in and of itself isn't a bad thing, there's also nothing wrong with a video game looking like one too. My main issue lies with distant level of detail, or LOD. It's just very jarring to have to look at these distant landscapes and see such disparity in visual fidelity. It might be an engine thing, I don't know much about these things, so I won't even attempt to make more assumptions. Animations can be a mixed bag though. Generally speaking, apart from combat animations still being stiff, everything else looks good enough for me. Everything, except the facial animations. That's different from lip sync, which is actually pretty fucking good. Just facial expressions during dialogue or cutscenes. Let's take a look at some examples.
What the hell?
Oh, and here's my favorite.
Smug face.
So, what are you doing hanging with this little shit? You two are pretty fucking funny, you know that? Seriously, I haven't laughed so much in my whole fucking life.
Let us move on to sound design. Voice acting is pretty good across the board, which is surprising as it tends to be a bit of hit and miss in their games, but I feel like they finally managed to make it work. Can't say there are any truly outstanding performances, but they're all at the very least good. Jax, Kaya and Falk are definitely the top performers. Sound effects are very much a mixed bag though. Certain weapons and guns kind of just sound meh, I guess. They tend to sound very benign. They lack this sort of oomph. A certain meatiness is missing from a lot of these sounds. I will say though that it's mostly a ranged weapon issue rather than melee, as those tend to sound decently enough. Credit where credit is due, I can appreciate the fact that weapons produce different sounds depending on what they hit. Sand, grass, rocks, metal, it's a nice touch. I gotta say though, I am not a fan of the soundtrack. Aside from the Berserkers theme, I don't think I actually liked a single track. Some of it even sounds like some royalty-free, we'll do it for exposure type of a deal, which is very odd. Elex 2 is by no means a phenomenal game. Piranha Bytes is by no means a AAA developer. But this music is just way below par. Just listen to some of these. They suck. They just very genuinely suck ass. Performance is okay-ish, although that's not exactly what I expect from a PC-focused developer. Recommended system settings are Ryzen 7 2700 or an i5-9500F, and an RX 5700 XT or an RTX 2060. And faction settlements, particularly the crater, ran very poorly on my rig. I played the game on 1440p, high settings on Ryzen 7 3700X and a 2080 Ti, and the frame rate would sometimes drop as low as high 30s. Outdoors performance was fine, and I'd say that overall the game averaged at around 60fps. My experience with bugs was very limited. Thankfully, and surprisingly, not once have I had to reload the game, and it only crashed twice. But as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, I did play with two mods, so I can't really blame the game for something that could just as easily have been caused by modifications. Before I conclude the video, let me just make a couple of extra points. Piranha Bytes has a YouTube channel where they post frequently asked questions videos and such, and I actually sat and watched a bunch of those. In a way, it helped me understand why the games are the way they are. They talk about ensuring that the complete package is fun to play, fun to engage with, rather than focusing on perfecting specific aspects of their games. Their philosophy is that there is always a bigger fish. Now, there is absolutely nothing wrong with that outlook, but it's just frustrating because whether I like it or not, I am a fan of theirs, a disgruntled fan, but a fan nevertheless. I own every single one of their games. For over 20 years, I've been buying their products. Well, I probably wasn't spending my own money when I was 10, but you get the idea. Meanwhile, they are probably laughing at me like, yeah, keep shuffling that shit down his throat. He doesn't care. In fact, he seems to enjoy it in some sick way. I genuinely believe that they have what it takes to create an amazing game, to provide us with a truly unique and unforgettable experience, just like they did all those years ago. Perhaps reduction in scope is the way to go for them? I would much rather have a 40-hour game I'm willing to replay than an 80-hour slog through mediocrity. Piranha Bytes also mentions that the people interested in their games are aware of their existence and will sooner or later find their way to them. Again, nothing inherently wrong with such lack of competitiveness. It's just a shame. A goddamn shame is what it is. Elex 2 is a video gamey kind of game. It doesn't reach for the stars. It doesn't strive to achieve greatness nor realism. Aside from the jetpack being seriously convenient and seriously fun to use, I really can't think of any other aspect of the game that I thoroughly enjoyed. And while it's definitely an improvement over Elex 1, I am convinced that Piranha Bytes could have done better. I even provided examples here and there. And the thing is, those didn't even take me that long to come up with. Piranha Bytes continues making tiny improvements to their formula, but until they change the way they approach developing games, I don't have high expectations for Elex 3. I am sure they will make tiny improvements to certain aspects of the game. It will probably look marginally shinier than Elex 2, and while it will end up being fun to a minority of gamers, it is not going to gain any recognition. It will not reach new heights, and it's going to end up being as mediocre as its predecessor. Piranha Bytes, please prove me wrong. When can we expect the third entry? I'd say 2025, most likely. Patrons, thank you for your continued support. Not patrons, I invite you to sub and throw some money at me. You get charged by video, not monthly, so until I produce the next mediocre shit stain, your money shall remain untouched.
Don't hold back. Don't hold back. Send the fucking money, bitch.
Take it easy, Chooms. I'll see you in the next one.
Get the fuck out of here.